New Testament Church of God Sheffield, LK418, our vision. Our church will be one in worship, one in giving, and one in serving. Our oneness will cause us to focus on the needs of people rather than programs. A church where everyone will actively care for someone. A church where none are left behind. Bring yourself, bring your family, bring your friends. You are important to us. Our vision is our mission.
Good morning, brothers and sisters and friends. Thanks for joining us online again on another YouTube service. We're coming to you from Sheffield. We're giving God thanks for you being online to share with us today and to hear the word of the Lord. And we give God thanks for you. It's been a while. It's been a while since I've been on this platform. God has been good, and there is no other word that I could use today. In fact, there's no other sermon I think would be appropriate if I was to go solely on how I feel and solely on the expression of my own heart. There's only one sermon to preach, and that is that of gratitude and of thankfulness. I did that last week when we were in the house of God, and we'll be looking at the Art of Thanksgiving part two, because I'm grateful to God for all that he has done for me over these past few weeks. For those of you who haven't seen me online, I've not been well but returned now. I would like to thank you all publicly for your prayers and for your support and for your messages and well wishes. It's all very valuable. But I'm back now, whether you like it or not. I'm back. I'm back. And I'm back to enjoy you. I'm back to enjoy fellowship with you. We're going to go into the word later on. It's really, really important that thanksgiving should be seen not as something that we do necessarily when we feel like it, but to find a reason to praise God. I'm going to try and break that down in terms of giving God thanks when we're in pain, but also obviously giving God thanks when things go really well. But whatever condition we find ourselves in, as the writer said, we need to give the Lord thanks. So please enjoy the service today. It's great to be back, great to share with you. I pray and trust that you'll be blessed, and I'll speak to you in a while. Thank you so much again. God bless you.
If ever I love thee, my Jesus, it is now. Let's worship together as we sing and reflect on the words of this well-known hymn. Thank you.
beautiful day, my brethren. And it's a day that we can give thanks unto the Lord for his goodness. We think about all that he's done within the past year and beyond. And while we're thinking about that, there is so much to say thank you for today. And so I think I'll be going through a prayer of thanksgiving that I hope will fulfill all the things that each and every one of us have within us to give God thanks and praise for. Heavenly Father, we truly thank you for this day. It's such a beautiful day. And this is why one of the psalmists said, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. You're good. Your mercies endure forever." And because it's like this, Lord, we can think over the past year and the past months, the way that you've intervened, oh Lord, in the life, in each and every one of us lives, in the life of the body of Christ, the church, in our families, in our friends, in the midst, oh Lord, when it's sad, in the midst when it's painful, in the midst when there is nothing, in the midst when we're thinking what to do next, there you are, providing for us, comforting us and sustaining us by your mighty power. And for this, Lord, we must say thank you today. When we think, oh Lord, of the many times that our bodies are being ill, or we're praying for many people in our congregation that has been ill, or our families and friends that have been ill, and you intervene in a miraculous way, healing the bodies. And not only do you heal bodies, but you heal mind, and you heal the spirit of individuals when they're troubled. And Lord, for this we're giving you thanks today. If you did not intervene, many would have been in a terrible state today, but they come out victorious. Doctors are baffled. God, families are baffled by your miraculous work. And so, Lord, we give you thanks for this today, because you've healed our bodies, you've healed mind, and you've healed spirit. You've healed those who are cast down. You've lifted them up. And so we give you thanks for this. Lord, and again, we're giving you thanks for your sustaining power. If you weren't sustaining your children, then what would have happened? They would have given up. We would have given up. We would have been be so distraught that the enemy would have destroyed us individually and collectively. But because of your wonderful sustaining power, here we are giving you thanks, Lord, for all that you've done throughout the past years until now. We thank you so much for this. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for the church, for the body of Christ that you've kept, and for your people, and for your ministering servants, and for the congregation that you've kept throughout this time. So many more things could have happened, disastrous things could have happened, but because of your grace, because of your mercy, because of your love, and because of your sustaining power, here we are again together to worship you. Father, again for this we give you thanks and praise. When we look around the world today, the situation that the world is in, different parts of the world where the disease and are rampant, and we wonder sometimes what to do or what to say. But we know, Lord, that you are in the midst of all this storm, and in the midst of these storms that are happening, Lord, you are there to uphold and to keep your children and to remind us that you're God and you never fail. And certainly, Lord, we can see the miracles that happen in different countries. Oh, Lord, so many lives have been saved from the hand of the virus, from different diseases, from different sources, from different disasters. And for this, we're giving you thanks today. We thank you, Lord, because you always look after our welfare. Even though many times the enemy is telling us that you do not care. But God, we know that you care. There's a songwriter said, oh yes, you care. I know you care. Your heart is touched with our grief when the way grows dreary and the long night drearies. I know my Savior cares. And because you care so much for your people, so much for your church, so much for your children. Again, we thank you. So Lord, we continue to thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done. For the healing, for the provision, for the sustenances. We thank you for this, Lord. And we ask that you continue to be with us, your children, and be with us throughout this service today. The blessings and the glory and the honor belongs to you. And we praise you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus travelled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. When he saw them, he said, Go, show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Amen.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. On the behalf of our minister, Bishop Winston Taylor, his wife, Sister Daphne Taylor, and the leadership team, we welcome you to our morning worship service. This morning, we're asking you to please pray for all those you know who are sick and at home, and also those who are in the hospital. Please also continue to pray for all our families faced with bereavement during these challenging times. Tomorrow, Monday, the 10th of May, at 11 a.m. and again at 7:30 p.m. will be our next prayer line sessions. Please also remember to join us every Sunday morning at 7 a.m. for prayer. The number to join us in prayer is 03300881939. Access code is 499281 followed by the hash key. Please also join us in our Bible study series. The options are as follows. On Tuesdays is our New Life Bible Study classes. First one starting at 6:30 p.m. for all individuals aged 18 and under, and a second class starts at 7:30 p.m. for all individuals aged 19 years and over. Also on Tuesdays is our Kingdom Living Bible Study classes starting at 7:30 p.m. whilst on Wednesday we have our Spotlight Bible Study classes starting at 7:30 p.m. The Sheffield District Convention will be held from the 21st through to the 23rd of May. Further information will be made available to you. Also, the New Testament Church of God National Convention will be held virtually from the 23rd through to the 25th of July. Theme is Fearless Living. Please make a note in your diaries and further information will be made available to you. And finally, I leave with you Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Have a blessed and safe week.
Worship in giving. Thank you to all who continue to give to the church. To continue to support the work here at NTCG Sheffield, payments can be made into our bank account via bank transfer. The details you will need are as follows. Account number 70660906. Sort code 207697. Please use your name as a reference and state either tithe, offering, or gift. God bless you in abundance.
Oh, ever happens to you, because if it hasn't, I so hope it does. You could be out somewhere, at work, or even at home, and you randomly put your hand in your pocket and bingo, there's a $10 bill in there you'd forgotten about. Man, do I love that feeling. It's the best because ice cream or another treat is now in my immediate future. It's just one of those simple joys in life to find or be given something for free. But what if it started happening all the time? What if suddenly cash was always in my pocket? Well, first of all, I'd be eating way too much ice cream. And secondly, I wouldn't feel like I needed anything or anyone else because my pocket was always full of unexpected cash. I know this entire scenario is far-fetched, but something like this did happen to the Hebrews in the Old Testament. In Deuteronomy, the Israelites had finally settled in their promised land after wandering the desert forever, and it lived up to its name. God's people were suddenly given flourishing cities, homes, vineyards, olive groves, and a bunch of great things that they didn't make or grow themselves. That's a lot of stuff to find in your pocket. And God put it there for his people who he loved. So the Israelites begin to thrive in this promised land. And every minute of every day, they remembered God was the one that provided their needs. Their reliances and thankfulness for him grew to incredible levels, right? Nope. They totally forgot about the giver and fell totally in love with all the gifts they'd been given. Almost immediately, they started worshiping everything else rather than their heavenly Father. My word, that is so frustrating, right? If I were in their position, I would have never forgotten the Lord. And then I realized I do this all the time. James 1:17 says, "Every good and perfect gift comes from God." That means everything we have, not just the unexpected gifts, comes from our loving Creator. And it's so hard not to forget the giver and just focus on the gift. I've found the best way to remember who is behind every blessing is by simply saying thank you over and over again, because there are so many blessings in my life.
Bless the Lord, everyone. I give God thanks for the opportunity to be back on this platform again after a while away, and I give thanks that you can join us again on this platform as we once again delve into the Word of God and see what nuggets we can gain from God's precious Word as it applies to our lives. This week, I want to, I promised, if you were in the main house last week, I promised that I would continue the sermon series, The Art of Giving Thanks. And so I'm going to be dealing with part two this week, The Art of Giving Thanks. And in my message to you today, what I want to do is for us to be cognizant of the fact that the giving of thanks to God is not solely dependent on always having a release from our troubles. But I believe that God should be praised and given thanks in the midst of even the most difficult times and spaces within our lives. I want to also acknowledge, and I believe that I need to do this, to the audience, all you who are watching today, that the giving of thanks to God in the middle of personal difficulties, personal pain, personal angst and sorrow, is far more difficult, I know, than giving God thanks when everything is going well and you just had a deliverance from your issues. Yet I do believe that God would have us to know that in all things, there is always much to be thankful to God for. Somebody say amen to that. Praise the Lord. In preparation for this word today, I want to examine the account of the testimony of a writer that I came across when I was looking at this subject. His name is Mr. Richard Dean. Richard Dean wrote, and I quote, "God went to a lot of trouble to save me from his righteous wrath. After graduating with a master's degree in 1979, I began my career doing research in the field of immunology. Things went very well, and within 6 years, I had published 8 articles, 5 of which I was the primary author in a prestigious scientific journal and journals. I was running my own life, he says, and ignoring God until the day that I got very sick. They tested me and the tests revealed that I had Crohn's disease, a serious, incurable, inflammatory disease of the intestines. I found myself unable to do things, he continues, using my own strength and my own abilities. The medicines weren't working, and I found myself being bedridden in severe pain for 2 months. I cried out to God, he said, and promised to try to follow him and do what he wanted me to do, although the truth is I had no idea what that was at that time. Within 3 months, all symptoms of Crohn's disease had disappeared. It was a miracle that demonstrated God's love for me. 3 years later, when I heard the message of salvation, I was ready to accept it because I knew of God's love and power. I am even grateful, he says, for the suffering, since without it I would probably have never turned to God. Since that time, I have gone through other trials, although not pleasant, but they've made me grow in faith and reliance upon God. My wife was diagnosed with a brain tumor, and although originally given 3 to 7 days to live, she is now in remission, and the tumor has not grown since that time. The prospect of raising 3 active boys on my own, he says, is not something that I look forward to, but I know that God will give me the strength to do so, should that become necessary. He concludes by saying, the reality of life's fleeting existence has been a constant reminder and caused me to focus, and us indeed, as a husband and wife, to focus on the more important things of life. I wanted to include Richard Deem's testimony in my message today because I believe that if we are not careful, we can believe all too quickly that the problems we face in life are only for us. And nobody has the trouble like I'm having right now. That nobody is feeling the pain that I'm feeling right now. That my burden is too big for me to carry right now. We feel that the pressure we're under right now is going to cause us to go under, that the problem I'm dealing with right now is going to cause me to walk away from God, that nobody loves me, that nobody's willing to help me. And if we're not careful, saints of God, our pain will damage our hope and cause us to withhold the very thankfulness that I believe and the gratitude that we ought to be offering to God on a daily basis. In truth, you know, it's very difficult indeed to be in thanksgiving mode when your heart is broken. And nobody should seek to deny or seek to minimize the heartbreak that those circumstances bring. But what the preacher does, you see, and what the one who tries to comfort you does, what the counselor does, what the best friend does, is to offer perspectives for the way that we feel, working with us to help us to understand that something good can come out of our distress. The famous author Joni Erickson Tada wrote, often we want to question God's goodness when we endure difficulties or disabilities, diseases, death or destruction. We ask, where is God in all of this? In years past, she says, I have raised that question myself many times. She continues, decades spent in a wheelchair have not made me an expert in terms of giving thanks by any means. And I love how brutally honest she is there. She says, there are still many mornings I don't want to get up and face my wheelchair. I can't do this, I moan. I have no resources to face another day dealing with paralysis. But that's when I remember, she writes, that God has resources to spare. Lord, you have the strength I lack, I plead. I can't do this, but Lord, you can. Please help me to make it through this day with your strength and your patience and your joy. And she says, he does. She further says this, those who start their mornings on automatic cruise control without needing God are the truly handicapped ones. And she reminds us of what is written in the book of James 4 verse 6, which says that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Who are the humble? People just like you and me, who recognize our desperate need of our Savior. And thankfully, he gives strength to all who cry to him for mercy. Pain, you know, agony and distress is not a nice thing. But out of your pain, there comes this, what I call a qualification. Strange term to use, but it is. Out of our pain comes this qualification and the ability to empathize with others in a way that only you and I can. I say to you today, my brothers and sisters, that one reason to give thanks to God in times of trouble is that trouble provides you and I with an opportunity to help somebody else who's going through the same trauma. Allow me, if you will, just to finally explore the wonderful and empowering witness of Joni Erickson as she concludes by saying this. She says, my suffering taught me so much about myself and has bound me to other believers who deal with pain and affliction. The day-to-day suffering that never goes away has forced me to depend on his grace, strengthened my commitment to him, and purged so much sin from my life. Times of difficulty have deepened my prayer life, refined my faith, and stretched my hope. So each year, around about this time, I make a point to thank God, not in spite of my sufferings, but for it. I thank him for the better choice, the wiser answer, and the harder yet richer path. I thank him for showing me that there are more important things in life than walking. That's Joni Erickson's testimony. So now that we have heard from two people about giving God thanks during adversity, now let us consider the art of thanksgiving within the context of gladness. Huh? Let me now return to the text that was read by our brother Daniel this morning. If you refer again to the word, the text tells us that Jesus is making his way in a northerly direction, passing up through Samaria and then Galilee on his way to Jerusalem. While he is on his journey, the Bible says that Jesus arrives in an unnamed village. And as he enters, he encounters a group of 10 men, all of whom are described as lepers. You know, there has always been some disagreement historically about what leprosy meant back in Bible days. It is commonly compared to what we call Hansen's disease today. You know, the Bible briefly mentions some symptoms of this leprosy. It talks about scabs, it talks about white spots and about sore flesh and such like. But whatever the condition that they had, we know that it was a terrible condition. These men were treated, and women actually, were treated as outcasts. There at the time was no cure for this disease, which gradually over time left the person disfigured through more scabs, through loss of fingers, toes, and eventually loss of limbs. Leprosy sufferers had to leave homes and families and live together with other sufferers outside the city, outside the town, outside the villages where they resided. They would have had to scavenge for food. They were forbidden to have any contact with people who did not have their disease, and they would suffer the ignominy of having to ring a bell and shout, "Unclean, unclean," if anyone approached where they were. They could not go to the marketplace and were forbidden to take part in worship. Public, that is. And so this very much explains quite clearly why it was that Jesus met them, but met them, the Bible says, from a good distance away. It is here now that these men cry out to Jesus and say, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Now Jesus, watch Jesus. He does not draw any nearer to them. Jesus does not move closer to them in order to lay his hands upon them and to heal them. But Jesus simply says, "Go, show yourselves unto the priests." And the Bible says that as they went on their way to see the priest, the Bible says that as they went, they were cleansed of their diseases. You know, for me, this is such a beautifully rich text. It's full of possibilities for a whole plethora of sermons. I could preach many different sermons on this one text, on these few verses. But for the sake of this word, I want to join with the writer Luke. And I only want to focus on one thing, one aspect of the story. And that is the fact that only one of the 10 lepers returned to say thank you to Jesus for what he had done for them. Now, during my time growing up in church, I've often wondered why. Probably you are the same. Wondered why it was only one who returned and the other 9 didn't bother. You know, some writers have made a great play on the fact that the leper who returned to give thanks was a Samaritan, and they bring out the evangelistic side of that story, and that's fine. But for me, the fact that the one who came back was a Samaritan doesn't justify or answer the question as to why one came back and 9 didn't. This is especially mysterious to me because from the text, the first thing that we notice, brothers and sisters, is that all 10 of these lepers were men of faith. How do I know that? Because the word of God says that Jesus spoke to them and said, he didn't do anything, didn't walk up to them, didn't lay his hand on them. He simply said, "Go show yourselves to the priest." And these 10 men of faith heard the words of Jesus Christ, somehow believe what he said, and agree that if we go show ourselves to the priest, that in itself is the evidence that we will be healed. We don't know how it's going to happen, but let's be obedient to the word of the Lord. Not one of them experienced the laying on of hands of Jesus, but they all responded in faith to his command. And upon their active faith as they went, the Bible says that they were healed. But why did only one return and come back and say thank you to Jesus? Honest truth is, probably never know. Lots of conjecture, but we will never know, really, will we? We'll never know the psychological makeup of the 9 who went on. We'll never know why they didn't come back. It's not that they weren't grateful. Anybody would have been grateful for being delivered from such a disastrous illness. But we don't know why they didn't return. But what the story does do is to remind us that even people of faith sometimes don't do the right thing. And sometimes we ourselves do not remember to give God thanks for his mercies in our lives. Can you imagine the astonishing truth of this story? 10 men, come with me now. 10 men, can you imagine? 10 men who have been living lives ostracized by society, living on the outskirts of their city, town, or village, not allowed to interact with people who are healthy and whole, not able to mingle any further with their wives and their children and their cousins, their uncles, their aunts. They probably lost their jobs. They've lost their livelihoods. They've lost respect from the community. And basically, the rest of their lives are condemned to an almost non-existence. Then, one day, in the midst of your pain, Jesus comes along. He doesn't do the usual thing, like he did to lepers before. Others he touches. Yes, he does. Others he reaches out and touches them. But to these men, he does nothing. He doesn't lay his hands on them. He only speaks the word. And soon after, all the scales, as they walk, the Bible says, as they walk, the scales are leaving them. The sores are leaving them. The pus is leaving them. And as they go, the Bible says that the leprosy is gone. The white spots are no more. And suddenly their lives are transformed like they never dreamt that they would be. To experience all of these states of God. What a miracle that took place. And have only one of them return and show appreciation to Jesus and thanks to the one who made it happen. To me, I find it astonishing beyond belief. Yet I believe it speaks to us here today of our proclivity sometimes to forget the goodness of God in our lives. My message to you today is entitled The Art of Giving Thanks. And when I read this story, I am reminded that the art that I'm speaking of is the fact that our giving God thanks should be rehearsed. It should be practiced. It should be deliberate. If we have never been people that regularly give thanks, it is not too late to start doing it today and right now. Amen. Why do I say this? Because when I look deeper into the text, I ask myself this question, you know. So Jesus sends them away, and the Bible says, as they went. Have you ever asked the question, how far did they get? How far did they get between leaving Jesus on the journey to seeing the priest? How long down the road did they get? Was it 500 meters? Was it a mile? Was it two miles down the road? We don't know. How long, how far on their journey did they get before they saw what was taking place? How far did they get? Of course, we don't know the answer, but what we do know is that no matter how long the distance was, whether it was long or shorter, one man, one Samaritan leper, saw that he was healed and took time to stop and return to the village. It could have been a 2 mile walk. It could have been a 3 mile. It might just have been a few yards, but he returned to the village to try and find Jesus to say, thank you. Thank you for what you have done for me. And the Bible says that when he found Jesus, he fell down at his feet and he began to laud Jesus. He began to give God thanks for the wonderful miracle that had taken place in his life. When I see the text, I see that there's not even any evidence that they even reached the priest. But watch this. And this is wonderful. He doesn't reach the priest, but he heads back, finds Jesus, and automatically upon finding Jesus, he breaks the Levitical law in Leviticus 13, because it was a priest who was supposed to declare him clean before he goes back out in society. But he breaks the law. He sees his body. He sees his condition. He knows he's clean, and he's not bothered about circumstances or rules or regulations. He simply says, I've got to find Jesus. And when I find him, I've got to praise him and thank him for what he's done. Praise God. And when I think about this story, I am also reminded of the famous King David. Do you remember that story of when the Ark of the Covenant was recovered and they're coming now into Jerusalem and the crowd is singing with joy. And the Bible said that David closed are clothed only in an ephod, begins to dance before the Lord. I don't know what kind of dance David was doing, but it was a dance of joy. It was the dance of ecstasy, because the ark of the Lord, symbolizing the presence of the Lord, was now being come back into Jerusalem. And David didn't care about protocol. His wife did, Michal did, and she was really angry and really cross about her husband. Why, O king, would you dance like that? Why would you lower and undignify yourself? Why don't you follow protocol? You're the king. Why would you make an open display of yourself? But when God blesses you, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how far you are down the road. You've got to come back. When God blesses you, you're not really interested in protocol and what people think. But when God blesses you, all you really want to do is lift up your wonderful hands and say, God, thank you for my blessings. And this is the art of thanksgiving. And I would go further to say, not just thank you when you have been blessed, not just being thank you when God is with you during your pain, not just saying thank you when God has delivered you from an obvious crisis, but make it a daily thing to find a reason to give God praise, to lift up your wonderful hands and worship the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. I hope that sounds reasonable to you. My God deserves praise in every circumstance. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, you know, I told the church last week in the church assembly at Nursery Street that I, for one, refuse to be ungrateful. I must give God thanks now. Tomorrow is never a good time to give thanks. The time for God's elect, those who know the Lord Jesus, to give God thanks is right now. And even if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, we used to sing a song in school, all good things around us, if I get the words right, are sent from heaven above. So thank the Lord. Oh, thank the Lord for all his love. And that is applicable to all of us, believers, non-believers. Doesn't matter what denomination, whether we are people of faith or not. I believe that we must give God thanks for the things that are taking place in our lives. And remember that things can always be worse than what they are. I'll confess to you, and I said this to the brethren last week, there are some things, and you are the same, so don't look at me funny. There are some things in my life I've got to sharpen up on. Hallelujah. There are some things I've got to improve on, some things that need to be straightened out. And I'll be open and honest and admit that, but I am determined by the grace of Almighty God that the habitual, I call the habitual of giving of thanks will remain strong in my life. And I want it to be strong in your life also. Praise God. You know, my mother was a thanksgiver. You know, my mother never had a lot. She was this hardworking woman, just like your own mother. Never had lots of money, never had a lot of anything. But a legacy that she left behind is that she taught me through her daily giving of thanks to God. While she was in the kitchen cooking, while she was washing, whatever she was doing, she was never thought short, rather, of praise and thanks to God. And I like to think that a little bit of that has rubbed off on me. And I would wish that it would rub off on you. Find something to give God thanks for. You know, during her healthy days, she was always giving God thanks and praising him. But one thing that she left with me that I noticed, that in her days when she was sick and she was ailing, she always gave God praise. Every time I would see her, I would never see her, never spend any time with her without her giving God thanks for something. Even when her eyes were dim and she couldn't see her children and her grandchildren anymore and the world around her, even though that caused her great pain and distress, and we would often discuss the fact that her eyes were growing dim because of the cataracts and she couldn't see properly, she would always find a reason, praise God somebody, to give God thanks. Because in the midst of her life, in the midst of her pain, in the midst of her successes, in the midst of her failures, in the midst of her joy, in the midst of her angst, God still remained God. And in her eyes, God was worthy to be praised. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Brothers and sisters, the art of giving thanks means that we look for the providential power and the might of God in all circumstances. If you have been unjustly refused a promotion at work, don't weep, but thank God for the promotion and the better salary that is coming to you. Oh, hallelujah. Save your energy and your time for the promotion and the salary and the working conditions that God will provide. It's there, not yours. God will make a way. Hallelujah. When you don't see the finances that you need, just know that God will make a way where there seems to be no way, and God will send somebody to help you. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus that we will not be shivering wrecks. Hallelujah. Cowering in the little corners of life, but that we will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in our mouths. As a church, as a people, we will be thanksgivers. As a church, as a people, we will be praisers. We will every day of our lives find a reason to give God thanks. We will not be complainers. For we have learned, hallelujah, from the Apostle Paul, that we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Hallelujah. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are cast down, yet not destroyed. Hallelujah. Psalms 95 says, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Glory to God. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. Our brothers and sisters, one of the best things about thankfulness is that the more you choose it, the easier it gets. The more you profess gratitude, the more you notice things to be grateful for. By the grace of God, I am determined, let us be determined, hallelujah, that the enemy of our soul, the devil, is not going to win over in our lives and discourage us to the point that we cannot be thankful to God. He wants us to concentrate and complain on what we don't have, but I will bless the Lord and give thanks, oh, for the things that I do have. Will you do the same today? I pray that you would, in Jesus' name. Thank you so much, Lord, for waking me up this morning. Thank you so much, Lord, that you formed me, made me, and gave me the breath of life. Thank you so much, Lord, for the air that I breathe. Thank you so much, Lord, for the food that I eat and the water that I drink. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Lord, for family and friends and loved ones that you have blessed and brought into my life, dear Jesus. Thank you so much, Lord, for every brother and sister in this great big worldwide family of God that I can turn to when I need help. Thank you so much, Lord, for making known to me the path of life, for filling me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Thank you so much, Lord, that you are my glory and you are the lifter up of my head. Glory to God. Thank you so much, Lord, for removing the spirit of fear and giving me the spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. Thank you, Lord, for my family. Thank you, Lord, for my church. Thank you for my spiritual and physical health. Thank you, Lord, for my spiritual and physical health. Thank you for my physical and spiritual strength. Oh, glory to God. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So let's find a reason to thank the Lord, to thank the Lord for all his love. If you want to develop the art of thanksgiving, endeavor to lift your own self out of a sense of despair and make a personal choice to be thankful. I call this making a personal choice to rejoice. And even though it may be difficult to be thankful at certain times, we need to make a personal decision that we are going to be grateful people of the book, grateful people of God, even, and this is crucial, even when we don't feel like being grateful, even when we don't feel like being thankful. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul wrote these words from prison. Yes, prison, get that. He wrote this from prison. He said, rejoice in the Lord always. He wrote, and again I say, rejoice. Notice Paul says rejoice twice, as if someone could not believe that he could rejoice while being in prison. But Paul made a personal choice, saints of God, to be grateful despite the circumstances that he found himself in. He decided that even though he was unjustly imprisoned, didn't matter. He was going to praise and thank God. And by doing so, it transformed his perspective. I believe that thankfulness is a choice. It's a choice that all of us must choose to make. We must make a conscious decision that we are going to be grateful despite the circumstances of our lives. 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 18 says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And in closing, and for those of you that missed out on part one of this sermon last week, remember to develop. The key word in this word today is develop. Remember to develop the art of thanksgiving. Develop the daily discipline of giving thanks. In order to be thankful people, we need to get into the mode of giving God thanks every day. We need to discipline ourselves to find something each day that we should be thankful for and express our thanks to God. The hymn says, count your many blessings. Name them one by one. Do you remember that song? And it will surprise you, hallelujah, what the Lord has done. The Apostle Paul's life was filled with many difficulties, which he could complain about. How many of us would have put up with a constant stress, confusion, persecution, and beatings that left deep scars and permanent injuries, but still remain a confident outlook and a positive attitude to life? But Paul had learned an important secret to his life when he said, I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. Glory to God. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret, he says, of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you'll find that in Philippians 4, 11 to 13. And so, as we, by God's grace, continue on this journey called life, let us make a concerted effort each and every day to appreciate the many blessings of God. Our lives should be filled day by day with a spirit of thanksgiving. And Psalms 92 verse 1 reminds us, it is good to praise the Lord, hallelujah, and to make music to his name, to proclaim his love in the morning and his faithfulness at night. Find something to give God thanks for. Let us as Christians become filled with this wonderful spirit of thanksgiving and gratitude towards God for all the things he has done in our lives. Go ahead and find something to give God thanks for. Reach out to your husband or your children if you're near somebody right now. Give God thanks for them. When you wake up in the morning and see the birds, the brand new sky, when you see the sunshine, when you see that your limbs are working properly, when you see food on your table, when you wake up and look up and there's a roof over your head, when you know that your bills are being paid and God has made a way for you to work and raise your family. Consider your friends. Consider the material blessings that you have. Consider the hope that remains constant in your heart about a better future, and find a reason. It's an art. You practice it, you rehearse it, You're serious about it. You do it because you know it's true. It's an art. Practice the art of thanksgiving. And in doing so, you will grow. And the wonderful name of Jesus will be honored through you. I commend this word to you today. It is my prayer that you will be strengthened, as I have been strengthened in writing this text. May you be blessed today and for the week ahead of you. God bless you. God bless you. Brothers and sisters, the truth is, I don't know about you, but I've always been a mummy's boy. Always been a thank you boy. I learned it well from my mother. She ingrained that in me just to give God thanks. It's something that I don't struggle with, but I don't just do it parrot fashion. I know that God has been good and he's worth all the glory, all the honor, all the praise, all the thanks that I can muster. He is absolutely worth every one of those sayings and acts of gratitude that I can muster to give to him. Lying in my own hospital bed and having left after one night and having day surgery, walking out that room, I left behind two guys who were in a worse state than I was, not even sure that one of them was going to recover. Mighty men. One was a eminent teacher, lecturer, big, great in his day. But this sickness had reduced him to being someone just so dependent on the help of others. Another one was wheelchair bound, couldn't walk. We both had kind of the same condition, but I walked out of there, walked out giving God thanks, but they remained there in a condition. And I don't know if I'll see them again, but I did think to myself, Father God, it could have been me. And that's the truth. There's no point pretending. And I'm not glamorizing this or saying it just to make me look good or make you feel better. Our reality, our truth is that things could be so much worse. And you better believe it. You better believe it, especially those of you who are young and strong and vibrant and everything's kicking into place now. Your reality as life endures will change. I just want us to understand that everything that we're going through now is transient. Life is short. Let's look around. Let's look around us. Look around at the people in your life and find a reason. You won't even have to find one. They are there. They are evident. You know, the Bible says that the heaven and the earth declare the glory of God. Everywhere you look, there is something to be thankful for. And so I want to encourage you to make it an art. An art. Let you be the individual who shines that in your family, as one who knows how to give thanks to God for whatever situation you face. I trust and hope that you have been blessed by this word today. We continue to stay safe. We continue to obey the government guidelines. It won't be long now, another couple of months before they reckon that the shackles will be loosed and we can come back together and rejoice as before and just do normal things as we do before. But be careful still in the meantime. Obey government instructions, stay safe, and may God be with you as you enjoy today and the rest of this week. May God's peace be with you as you learn the art of giving thanks. Take care until we see each other again. God bless you so much. Bye-bye.
Come on, everybody, put your hands together. It's got to get better. All over the world, listen to these words. People come.
People come.
People go.
Your life has been
out of control.
Out of control.
You're confused. But don't worry.
Don't worry your soul. It will get better.
It's gotta get
better. It will get better.
It's gonna be
better. It will get better.
'Cause
God is in
control, y'all.
Your heart.